stranger traveling through this world of woe. But there's no sickness or danger in that bright land to which I go.
In my sorrow. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. You ready for the word of life tonight?
Amen.
Amen. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face and the things of earth will grow strange.
Just before we turn to the Word, perhaps I'll just allow you to have your seats once again, if you don't mind. I didn't know we came in this evening, and Brother Jeff asked, said quite a few of the young people, they'd been speaking to them and had not heard anyone give a live testimony of someone, from someone who had been with Brother Branham. And a matter of fact, it wasn't just too long ago this year, see Brother Jason Watkins and his wife here, he'd been speaking some of the services in this meeting, and he asked me to do the same thing. It really had been a long time since I did that, Brother Jason, and it was really truly a wonderful evening. Beyond what I had really expected, because to myself, I've given the account over and over, but it seems that God is pleased with the record and the testimony. And as time has gone on, I felt a little bit freer to add some things that I held back in years gone by. I feel that the body of believers is more mature just now, and they're able it's not that they're so difficult to handle, it's all very simple, but so that you understand where it's coming from. And, you know, years ago they might have thought, well, you know, Brother Biscoe's trying to make something out of himself or something. I was with the prophet and I fished with him and I hunted with him and so on. It has nothing to do with that. And so some years ago I just said, well, even at the expense of the people not hearing it at all, I'll just try to save myself some criticism, and that wasn't really good either. So we can't apologize for where we were and who we are, and we are what we are by the grace of God. And it was only God's grace that allowed me to have some encounter with Brother Branham. If that will be a strength, if that will be an encouragement, I know what I was like. I was a young minister, and I was just curious to know. One of the things is in the top of my mind, did Brother Branham act like a preacher? I just wanted to know, did he act like a preacher? So I was watching, you know, how he carried his Bible, and, you know, did he say hallelujah all the time? Or, you know, I just wanted to know if he acted like a preacher. And then I found out he didn't act like a preacher. And so we came up with those little surprises as time went on. And we didn't discover all these things in a few minutes or even a few days. So if that would be a blessing, we'd be very, very happy to do that. Amen. Thank you. Also, we were asked about Gershon Salmon's meeting. He's only been out of Israel four times up until this last time. This is his fifth time. And he's going to be with us a week after next, which is the 24th, 25th, and 26th. Two of the meetings, there won't be meetings like this, of course, because we're going to open the service and just set the service in a right atmosphere and then let him address the people. He knows nothing of Jesus Christ as the Messiah. He knows what we believe in, that we're Christians, but he has come to bear his heart and soul, and we want to see through him have a window to Naomi, the Orthodox Church. And so I have, over the weeks, more or less educated and prepared our people. We're not there to try to indoctrinate him. It'll take Elijah and Moses. And we're not going to attempt to take their place. So Brother Jeff just asked if I wish to make that known, and I'm happy to do so, and you certainly are welcome. The 24th, 25th is going to be in our own church, and we've prepared to have the large screen also in the fellowship room, because we will not be able to hold the people in the main auditorium. We're preparing for close to 1,000 people in the main auditorium. We're adding all the seats we can. And then we have gotten another fine auditorium that was built by a Pentecostal man who I do know personally. And we found out just recently that this man, he's one of Canada's wealthiest men. But when he was a young man in 1947, Brother Branham's organist didn't make it to the meeting in Vancouver. And we just found out a few weeks ago he played the organ for Brother Branham's meetings. And now here all these years later, we're getting to use the auditorium which he's built. It's a state-of-the-art auditorium. Actually, he built the whole school and donated it to a Christian school, about a $22 million school. So I think that that's fine that God puts that in the hearts of men, and may God bless him for that. We've had some question also about the painting and the prints of the painting. I would just like to say we just brought a few. I'd even forgotten. I was so moved the other night presenting it to Brother Lonnie and Brother Jeff, and I'd forgotten. We did bring some small ones, and we left them there at the back, and we just did a limited number of them, and once again we may be people may have thought we did the wrong thing, but I just didn't want to just produce a mass and scatter them all over the world sort of thing. And we made a project out of it, and we felt that what we'll do with this limited edition is, I didn't feel I could do anything more, anything better than to honor the message that came through his lips. And we have some projects in mind. And incidentally, I would like to say to you, we just heard today from India, and there's a wonderful printing operation in Madras, India, which your pastor knows all about. In fact, it was Sister Gladys Dow, who is known, I'm sure, to almost everyone, who provided the funds for the building, and it's called the Gladys Dow Memorial Building. It's a lovely two-story structure. And God has prospered that work till, having started in 1980 with one major language and printing just a few thousand a month, till today printing in 14 major languages, between 30 and 40,000 books, message books a month. And we run out of storage space, and the Lord has made a way for us to put the third floor on, and the third story is just being completed right now and adding to that building. And we're so happy for that. You know, God has done so many wonderful things that we could just stay here all evening talking about it. It's just one miracle after another. And we're just so thankful just to be a part of it. I was going to show you just a few pictures, would have taken about 10 minutes. We may be able to do it tomorrow morning, of China. It was actually the house we were arrested in. It was right at the meeting. I don't know if some of the pictures are the very night we were arrested. I happened to have the disc while I was speaking, when I stopped and everything fell silent. And all the police, you can hear them filing in. You can hear the cell phones going. And then I just say to my interpreter, I think it's trouble. And I didn't even remember saying that, but it was indeed trouble. But in the midst of all of that, I have a picture of a very fine, handsome Chinese man, probably in his mid-30s, meeting in a small house group, underground group, about 1,500 miles up into the north interior of China, and these handful of people were meeting, and God spoke to them somehow, supernaturally by the Holy Spirit, and said, new truth is being revealed in the south of China. So they put their money together and sent that one man, Brother Gao, on a journey. And he began a journey that took him 30 hours on the train. In that 30 hours, he passed city after city after city of 4 million, 6 million, 5 million, 8 million. And he just kept moving and moving and moving. Sometimes those cities are right close together. Remember, he's making his way through 1.25 billion people. You talk about the gene of God coming to the place of conception. Hallelujah. Can you fathom this? Brother Branham said it might not have been the first germ it hit, see? And there it makes its way all the way down to a certain city, and he stops. The man he meets in that city, one of the men he meets at least, I don't know how many others he met, but one of the men is not a believer, he's not a Christian. China's not a Christian nation. And he met this man and told him his purpose. This man said, well, I have a man who works for me that you may want to talk to. You know, he believes this, or he believes like you. And he brought him to that factory and introduced him to our brother who's in charge of the office and in charge of the work. He's a little pastor in the city of Shenzhen, and introduced him to him. And he told him why he was there. God has spoken supernaturally and said there's new truth being revealed in the south of China. And Brother John Lee said, that's exactly right. You come with me. Amen. They lived together and stayed there for a couple of weeks, a week or two. And he went back to the far north of China with boxes of books. Well, now he is back when we were just over there now, and he's working there and becoming grounded in the message. And oh, I tell you, God's ways are unsearchable. They're past finding out. Isn't it wonderful? Well, we've had a full week, and I don't want to. Well, did I tell you? I know some of you have been to other meetings where we've been. How many have not heard how all the message books got delivered into China? Did you hear about that? How many didn't hear about that? Oh my, well, that's quite a few hands. Well, we had a lot of message books printed in Hong Kong because we thought as soon as China swallows up Hong Kong, which was July last year, then there'll be no problem at all just getting them across the border. And I'll tell you what, many people from here, America, Canada, Europe, go over to China and some of these communist countries, and they think, oh, I went through the border. They looked, they saw I had tapes and books. They didn't pay a bit of attention. They just let me go. Praise the Lord. God just blinded them. Yeah? What they did was they put a tail on them and followed the individual to every home, every place they went, every book, and had the addresses of the people where the books were all left. And let that individual, let the foreigner go scot-free, but the people that received the books, I tell you, they were in big, big trouble. And some tourists, not very long ago, went and they handed out some tracts and booklets and everything else. And when they arrived at the border to leave the country, the border officer handed them all the things they'd handed out, gave them back to them. And that was the first time they found out they were being tailed. We had thousands of books, seals, church ages, choosing of a bride, seed is not heir with a shuck. And we had them in 9 different locations, stored and printed and waiting to take them into China. And here, as soon as Hong Kong was swallowed up by China, the borders tightened up even tighter than they were before, because they were afraid that the attitude of democracy might filter into China, and they didn't want that. And so we found it quite impossible. Brother John Lay, that's not John Lee. Now, John Lee is a pastor in China, one of them. But John Lay is in my church in Cloverdale. And he was over there, and he spends 2-3 months at a time. So he was there with Brother John Lee, and he was talking to some people, and they said, well, you know, it might be possible to get some things from Hong Kong. You know, you can maybe talk to a transport company. So he went and talked to a transport company. Everything is owned by the government, you see. And when we go over there, you know, it's not in our line of thought. So he walks into this transport company, and there's a few people in the front office, and he asked them, can you ship some things from Hong Kong here for us? And the question was, well, what kind of things? Well, it's some Christian literature. And they all began to laugh in the office. You want us to deliver Christian literature? I don't think, you know, it's not possible. Do you wish to speak to our leader? It's always called the boss, the leader. Well, yes, we'd like to speak to your leader. So out he comes and takes him into his office. What can I do for you? Well, he said, we have some things. We have cartons of literature that we'd like to bring from Hong Kong. And he said, what kind of things are they? He said, well, it's Christian literature. And this man said, well, he said, my mother is a minister up in far interior China, and she can't get any literature. If you will give her some literature, he says, I will bring your material across. Do you know what the real punchline is here? That was a communist-owned, government-owned transport company. And they hauled 9 cases and had them there the next day. Right into China. And we had books and thousands of books to distribute, and God has been so gracious. I was gonna show you these brothers' pictures, but maybe tomorrow you'll get a chance to see them. We've had a good time, haven't we? And I don't want to delay the word now, and I just trust you be on the edge of your seats and pray for me, and let's pray for yourself as well. Let's stand now, and we'll approach him in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, this has been a grand time that we've been able to be together. There are so many, Lord, that I've just been able to see in passing. It causes me to think over the years, many years ago, when the gathering was much, much smaller. And I think of the time in Lima, Lord, even in a double garage that was prepared, and many of those believers now have gone on before, Lord. And we just think about these great warriors, those that received this message in its early days, remained faithful down through the years. And Lord, here as you have gathered others of the body, the bride of Christ, and we can only think of this just now, when the last one comes, we're going home. And oh Lord, how we yearn to go home. How we desire to lay down our weapons of this warfare. And then to come into that place of rest and peace. And to be able to embrace one another and know that there'll never be another temptation. Never be another trial. There'll never be another tear. Lord, there'll be no more pain. There'll be no more death. We won't attend any more funerals. And Lord Jesus, we've all been touched with sorrow and grief and sadness in one way or another. But I pray that even you, your own presence tonight, will just grace us in such a blessed and near way, Lord Jesus. I pray you'll be so near. Anoint me now, Father, I pray, and the people to hear. And may the thoughts that are expressed be your thoughts. We thank you for this message, a faithful messenger. How faithful he was to the cause. Jesus Christ, in your name now be glorified. Amen. Amen. While you're standing, if you'll turn to 2 Peter, the first chapter, I will read verses 19 and 20. 2 Peter 1. 19 and 20. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. Hallelujah.
Amen.
No prophecy is of any of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. And I'd like you to notice that we have also a more sure word of prophecy. And while you're standing, one verse in Philippians, if you'll just turn back to the second chapter of Philippians and verse 13. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. May God bless his word to our hearts as you have your seats. Peter has said, we have a more sure word of prophecy, a more steadfast word, a word of force, a word of power. We happen to have that word. We're not the ones who put the force in it. We're not the ones who made it steadfast. We're not the ones who have energized it. But it's absolutely essential that we recognize that the word which God sent under such vindication, we know the vindication doesn't leave. God sent it with that vindication so that we could have a confidence that this is not of man. It wasn't of man when it came, and it's not of man now. And the word which you have, you embrace, is a word of force. Now, it demonstrated its power in the prophet's ministry because it was confirming that it was a supernatural message. And he said it was the word of God that was quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. But you see now, for us, for him, it was to gather the attention of the people. He said that even the healing and the signs and the wonders was to catch the attention of the people. Now, when we are sick, naturally we want to be healed. And God is a God of signs and wonders and miracles. But we don't need our attention caught. We've already been caught. We're already in love. The force of that word now, it is a multifaceted power. The power that worketh in us is a life-transforming power. It's a life-changing power. As Brother Jeff said just before he left the platform, each one of us has some weakness, some frailty, something maybe we've struggled with. That's why God has put power in the word, so that we can overcome that. Not by your power, not by our strength, but by his spirit. We do not have to be plagued with those things. I assure you at the beginning of this service tonight that the God of Elijah is here on the scene. The God of the message is here on the scene to see that you do not have to go through life. Don't you let the devil lie to you. Hallelujah. This is a word of force, of power. And it's for you. We have a more sure, firm, forceful word. And it's of no private interpretation, which is, it's not given to anyone to expound personally. It is not something that someone would leave obscured. The interpretation is to make it clear. The message is not belonging. A private interpretation means it does not belong to oneself. Now, there are men who have raised up within the message that have made it as though it was their personalized revelation. This is not a private revelation. This is a revelation for the bride of Jesus Christ. It's not some little personal. It's not mine. It's not any other minister's. One thing for sure, you can be confident, this message was brought for the whole bride of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And we're here tonight joyfully feeding upon it. I'm speaking to you upon the interpretation of the bride, of the word in the bride. You are an interpreter of the message. And I will be giving you many quotes on this, so just listen very closely. Now, in events made clear by prophecy, Brother Branham said, at the end of each age, when the church age has turned to the world and sin, and leaning upon man's interpretation of the word, when the world turned, that's when God sent his interpretation. And they had their own interpretation of the word. In questions and answers, he was speaking on 1 Corinthians 13, when that which is perfect is come, that which is in part shall be done away with. So all these little things of jumping up and down like a kid and trying to talk in tongues and all these other things, when that which is perfect, and he stops, and we do have today, by God's help, can you say amen? Amen. The perfect interpretation of the word with divine vindication. Amen. We do have it today. We have it today. We have it this evening. We have the perfect interpretation of the word with vindication. Now, in the scriptures, we see a pattern regarding interpretation. And there may be more, but I, for the purpose of this service tonight, there are three ways that I see in the scripture that God has used to interpret his word. The first is by a spoken word. He interprets it by speaking it. Then secondly, he will interpret the word by living out that spoken word. It was spoken prophetically, then it is lived out. That word is lived out in front of the people. And that also is a second means of interpretation. Then I will show you some examples in the scripture where it was prophesied, spoken clearly. Then the time came, it was lived out to the letter and still was not understood. And God came in what I call an additional measure of grace, turned back around to show his elect what they were expecting to happen had already happened. Now, Brother Jeff got on to preaching my message last night. I don't know how that anointing jumped on him, but he started preaching. One brother asked me, he said, I saw you smiling as Brother Jeff was speaking at the end of the service. He wasn't on your subject, was he? I said, yes, he was. And I said, furthermore, I have to confess, I actually bowed my head and said, Lord, stop him. God has a mind, doesn't he? So now you remember those three steps in the interpretation. He speaks it, lives it out, and then after it's been lived out, we'll come back in an added measure and make known what has been fulfilled. And lean not to your own understanding. God's own interpretation is the manifestation of the promise. God said it, then he did it. He said it doesn't need any interpretation. See? How does he interpret his own word? By fulfilling it. The Bible said a virgin shall conceive. She did. That doesn't need an interpretation. Let there be light, and there was. It doesn't need any interpretation. So when the season for this fulfillment or the interpretation of the word, when a season arrives, nothing can stop it. Nothing can stop it. In the way of a true prophet, the prophet said, roar, O Lion of Judah, let your prophets cry out. When God speaks, who can keep from prophesying? It's the word of the Lord. It's the word of God coming out of the Bible. Listen to this, moving up through the prophet. How can he hold his peace? If he would blow to pieces.
I say to you as a body of believers, it's not you or I, it's the Word of God coming out of the message, moving up through the bride, and we cannot hold our peace. It will manifest, and we cannot restrain it any more than we could resign ourselves from being a member of the family we were born into. You were born into that family. You have family traits and family resemblances, and you can do nothing about it. Oh, we have a heavenly father, a heavenly parent, and we are like him. So Philippians said, Paul to the Philippians, he said, for it is God which worketh in you, both to do, both to will, and to do his good pleasure. Now I have to watch that. It's a very short verse, but an extraordinarily powerful verse. It is God, that's number one. Not you, not what you learned, not what you think you understand. It's God. It's this force. It's this energy which is already deposited in the Word that is working in you now. If you try to stop it, you'll blow up. Amen. It is working in you now to do two things, to both to will and to do his good pleasure. To show forth, this word worketh. It's very simple. In the Greek, it's the same as energy. It's where our word energy comes from. It is to show, now watch closely, to show forth oneself. That's God. To work effectually in. To be operative. To put forth power. To display one's activity. May I just connect these together? It is God that is showing forth himself. It is God that is working effectually in you. It is God that is doing the operating. It is God that is putting forth his power, and it is God that is displaying his activity in you. I'd like to rephrase it if I might. It is God that is manifesting his attribute, working effectively and effectually by his own power, displaying himself through you. And this word, both to do, both to will and to do. To will. The will. This word that is used is very rich, because it leans right away to the desire. I want you to know something, friends. God's not just out here trying to wind us up like a little toy and send us off across the floor or across the globe. That's not what it is. God has raised you up because he had himself within himself a desire. We talk about our deep desires. We don't know anything about desire compared to God's desire. He knows what it is to have intense desire. His will involves his desire. He has a desire to work in you. And because he has a desire, he has a determination that nothing will stand in his way. He yearns to work in you. He yearns to be effectual. He's saying, I will show forth myself. I will be the operator. I will be the energizer. I will be effectual and show forth myself in this one. It's one to be resolved. Now he has a resolve. I don't want you to forget this, because it's going to come to the scripture in a few moments that I want to dwell upon. God is so resolved. He's so determined. I don't care how weak you might feel, how lifeless you might feel. If you are an elect of God, there's no way that he's going to leave you. There's no way he's going to leave your mind clouded. He's going to clear it up. Hallelujah. There's no way he's not going to reveal himself to you, and that ought to make everybody rejoice. I'm standing here tonight declaring he will reveal himself to every son and daughter of God. The prophet tells us in Christ is the mystery of God revealed, and you all know these so very well, but I say this and repeat these things for some of the young people and some of the newer ones. There were things that were in God's mind, and Brother Branham said he wanted to express himself. That was one of his great threefold purposes, was to express himself, identify himself with human beings, to reveal himself in Christ. First, to express himself completely, God in Christ. Second, to have the preeminence, and you know what preeminence is. By this in his church, which is his body, bride. And thirdly, to restore the kingdom to the rightly position that fell by sin, by the first Adam, back where he walked in the cool of the evening and talked with them, fellowship with them. And now sin and death have separated them from his presence and the entire expression. Now, sometimes the gospel presents us with questions, not only answers. I want you to think about this. When God was finished and he had Adam and he looked upon it and said, it's good, it's very, very good. He had a son of God, didn't he? Whose blood was in Adam? It's created blood. It was pure blood. Then Eve came, and Eve was the first one to fall. Now, why didn't God have Adam die for her and resurrect him? He was the first son of God. His blood was pure. He could have died a sacrifice. But on the other hand, he couldn't. Do you know why? The garden in its perfection, and the garden with Adam and Eve there, while it was still in its perfection, was perfect but not complete.
Right, brother. Amen.
Because the fullness of his expression included you, and you were not there yet. You were part of the expression. There were thoughts in God's mind that were not completed. Even though his thoughts, the prophet said, are not like a blueprint that will materialize, he said, the thoughts of God are real. They're eternal and they're real. You were as real back then as you are tonight to God. But the expression had to come forth. Now, when God had finished completed his creation, the prophet tells us that the great eternal God and the Logos came out from God, began to create things, and they were the thoughts of God being made manifest. I have a number of quotes here. Said God desired to become tangible. He wanted to materialize. That great eternal spirit wanted to materialize. And when he saw the materialization or that his thoughts becoming tangible, he looked upon it and said, it's very good. And the scripture tells us that on the seventh day, he rested from all of his works. In other words, he rested from bringing forth his thoughts into materialization. But what he did was, he turned the responsibility of his thoughts into the hands of his son. And he said to him, you look after those thoughts. You dress it. It'll take some labor, but you care for it. Now, if I asked each one of you your name and your descent, where you descended from and where you came from, and you say, well, I'm Irish and I'm German and I'm Scottish and I'm Norwegian or I'm Russian or I'm American or I'm something else. Well, you ought to change your language completely. You ought to say, well, first, First and foremost, I am an attribute of God that came into time from eternity. That's my first calling. I am a manifestation of the thought of God, and now God has revealed this to me, and He has put me in charge of this thought. God has given you responsibility, and I can prove to you by the message, you are a thought of God. But that isn't where it ends. That's just where it begins. And now God wants you to keep and dress that manifestation. You watch that thought. You care for that thought. You dress that thought. You labor over that thought. So that it is a beautified attribute of Almighty God.
Yes, sir.
Amen. It's a powerful thing to think that God gave that kind of responsibility in the infallibility of God's word. Brother Branham said, and the thought was created by God Himself. I mentioned that the other night, but I want to reemphasize it. God didn't just think something. He created those thoughts.
That's right.
Now, I don't know if I can adequately explain this, but here's another question, a puzzling question. Brother Branham says God can't learn anything. He knew the end from the beginning. And His thoughts are a part of Himself. Now, within your own mind, and you are in the image of God, within your own mind, You don't ponder now very deeply and say, now I've got to plan this. I am going to rise up off this chair. Let me plan this now. I'm going to make my way over to the door. I'm going to scheme. Now, yes, I think I'll put forward my hand and take a hold of the doorknob. And I will turn it and open it. Yes, this is the plan. No, you don't. That's not really, that doesn't require the kind of thoughts. There are different kind of thoughts. You just get up and do a certain thing and you don't give a whole lot of thought to it. Now, the scripture tells us that the first thing that was created was angels. He first created angels, and the angels worshiped Him. Some of those angels were capable of falling. And some of those angels were not capable of falling, could not be deceived by Lucifer. Those two types of angels cannot be from the same type of thought. Because one of those thoughts are actually a part of God and cannot be lost. And there are those, and that battle fell upon humanity. The battle of angels, the war of angels, fell upon humans, Brother Branham said. And now the warfare is here, taking place in the minds of the people. Some of those people can never be deceived. Can never be deceived. No how? Because they are from the eternal thoughts of God. I'm taking it right back before the beginning. And there are others who, like the fallen angels, will fall to the same destiny and be annihilated, and no part of God can be annihilated. So you do what you want with that. I believe that way back in the back part of God's mind, and He allowed a prophet in this generation to actually journey there and tell us what was there. And that's where, when you read Christ is the mystery of God revealed, don't you forget please, I speak to you kindly. Don't you forget that God allowed the messenger of this day not just to go back 24 hours and somebody's experience said, I see you at a doctor's office, not just to go back 6,000 years and tell us what happened in Eden, but to go back into the eternity before there was an angel, before there was stardust, and go back into the back parts of God's mind. And when God was there residing all by himself, and he said, alone with his thoughts, he thought about a family. That's the thought that can never be lost. He thought about children. He began to think about this bride, a multi-member. I'll have a multi-membered bride. And he began to think about each individual, that great mind of God that knows every gnat, knows every insignificant thing and creeping thing in the earth. But he thought about somebody he could fellowship with. I'll have a person, I'll have individuals, I'll have a many-membered body, and I'll live in them. I'll have fellowship in them. Oh, my brother, my sister, that puts it on a different level. He created that thought. In the beginning, when he thought of you, Brother Branham said, in future home, and thought of others like that, he said, thought of himself of being tangible. Hello? When he thought of you and others like you, the one sitting next to you, when he thought of you, young people, good percentage of this camp, you need to understand, for when you leave these meetings, I pray that the Holy Spirit will bring these things back to you, captivate your thought, and you'll listen. Remember that Brother Biscoe told you, you're not of this world. Quoting the scripture, you're of another world. You came from the thoughts of God. And when we say the thoughts of God, we don't say that lightly. We don't just pass over that lightly. We're talking about when he was all alone by himself, residing back into the eternities, thinking about a family, thinking about fellowship. He thought of you. And others like you. And then he thought of himself becoming tangible. No wonder Jesus said, I and the Father in me, and I in you. God dwelling behind human skin. You've got to be able to testify and witness of the truth. God is behind this veil. God was so determined to become materialized. He said, everything you see tonight, do you know that everything you see tonight is God's word materialized? Your body is God's word materialized.
That's right. Amen.
Can this congregation say amen?
Amen.
He didn't give you that body simply to be destroyed. He didn't give you that body so that Satan could run roughshod over it. He gave you that body as an image of another body that you have. You'll bear the same image, and you have another body, a youthful body. You that are in the prime of your youth, you can be thankful. But those of us that have some years behind us, we have a body right beside us. So do you, everybody. These children have a body, same age as mine. Just beyond the veil. Hallelujah. And one day we're going to take a little step into that body. That will prove his great victory. You have that body. It's a perfect body. And this body was his word materialized. He gave you this one to live in for a short time. He said in the beginning he lived alone with his attributes. And then came his son and the fall and so on. But he is committed to us in this generation. He's committed us the manifestation of those thoughts. He's given you charge. And that manifestation is the interpretation. A lot of people don't know what Brother Branham said, but they are seeing what he said. There are multitudes that will never read a book.
Yeah, come on.
But they are reading Brother Branham's messages
right.
every day.
Amen. That's right. That is right.
They'll never hear a tape, but they're actually hearing his voice.
Right.
Because they're seeing the product of that voice in you.
Yeah.
You believe that?
Yeah.
You are the interpretation of the word being lived out. They'll never hear the spoken word, but they will see the interpretation of that word being lived out. And I'll tell you furthermore, they could read it and not understand it, but they will see it in you interpreted. I spoke about Joseph last night. Did you enjoy it? Now, I'm glad we had all of that background last night so we don't have to give it all tonight. But you know, I just refer now to Joseph. He spoke the dreams. There's the sheaves in the field. My sheaves stood up. Yours all bowed down. Well, that didn't really need any interpretation. I'll tell you that they understood the dream because they got mad. They couldn't say, I don't understand. This is a total mystery, Joseph. What are you doing? No, it wasn't a mystery. They understood it very clearly, and they got angry with him. They had another dream, and the sun and the moon were involved. And his parents heard it, and they understood that they were the sun and the moon, and they didn't like it either. And they were upset with him. Who do you think that you are? They understood the interpretation, so that was in spoken form. Then he had to begin to live out his own dream. Now, follow me closely. It's the last night. From the time that God does something dramatic, he shows you, oh, I'm in that number, white robe number. I'm going to a table, I've been called, I'm one of the elected. Oh, what a revelation. But between that time and the time those brothers were bowing down to him, God didn't tell him, you're going to be hated. This revelation, when it come to you, you thought, oh, hallelujah, everybody wants to know. I'll run in and tell my family. And what you found out, your family said, we're not going to bow to that. You think we believe you're a part of the bride? Come on. Come on, Joseph. He said, goodness, I didn't know. My, this wonderful thing happened to me. They don't like it. Furthermore, God didn't tell them, hey, Joseph, you're going to go to a pit. No, he doesn't tell us everything either. And pretty soon Joseph finds himself hated, disdained, misunderstood, and put in a pit. And he hears his brothers, I think we ought to kill him. No, don't kill him, Reuben says. You'll have the judgment against us. Now let's do something else. And finally he's sold. And there he's riding off with some merchant men into Egypt. A little farm boy, the loved of his father. Hated now of his brethren, off on his way to Egypt to be sold as a slave. No, he's on his way to interpret the word. Hallelujah. You got yourself maybe down into some pit experience. You got yourself into some place where you felt you were working as a slave for some taskmaster. No, my brother, my sister, you're there to interpret the word of God. He gets down there into Egypt, and I won't go through the story. He has all kinds of experiences. He's tempted. He's tempted in the flesh by Potiphar's wife. He is misunderstood. There's evil reports about him. He ends up in prison, down in the dungeon. He finally, after a couple of years or so, gets freed. And he gets, now Pharaoh has a dream. You know, sometimes we in our Christian life, we say, you know, the last time I did that, I got in trouble. Last time I interpreted a dream, last time I witnessed, I lost my job. I think I'll just hold my peace this time. Oh, it's the spirit of the word that's moving up through you. If you try to hold your peace, you blow up. You can't hold your peace. You enjoy it if you want to. I'm enjoying myself here this evening. No, he couldn't hold himself. I can interpret that dream. So he interprets the dream and tells him about the seven good years and the seven bad years. And Pharaoh says, you're the man to do it. And so what does he do? He has to start interpreting what he spoke. He spoke it. He explained it. He expounded on it. He interpreted it, told it exactly what was going to happen. Now Pharaoh says, you're the man. All right. So he steps in and he begins to interpret his dream by his life. And he did exactly what he said should be done. He interpreted the word perfectly. And now he made Pharaoh the greatest Pharaoh of all the earth. And Joseph was at his right hand, which he had to be. And he's fulfilling. But he wasn't even up there. Listen, Brother Branham said he was a perfect type of Jesus Christ. You can't find a place where Joseph felt that surge of joy, saying, my, think of it, I'm the perfect type of the Messiah. Never entered his mind. That's why we have to preach so hard that it's God that works in you. Because very seldom, I know what it's like. It's even hard enough right here in church to get you to believe it. But walking down the street, going through the mall, going into the schools, into the halls of learning and at the job and hearing the filthy conversation and the music blaring in the restaurant and everything. It's hard to say this is deity walking in human flesh. This is a son of God. When's the last time you walked into a business place and said, a son of God is walking into this place? It was Sister Laston, the woman I mentioned before. I won't even go into it. The book is written of whom the world is not worthy. Many of you sisters especially, I'm sure, have read it. And it was my joy to lead her to the message. She was 15 years old. How many 15-year-old girls do we have? Would you put up your hand? Not ashamed to put up your hand. Several. She was your age. Exactly your age. I saw the hearth that she was sleeping on in this home. The home was 200 years old. The hearth and the door right there where this man walked in. He was 35 years older than her. 55, I believe, at that time. And he walked in the door. It was around midnight. There was snow outside, so all they could see was the feature of this tall, strong man. He knocked on the door with a big, strong knock, and the stepfather was an alcoholic, and he opened the door, and this girl jumped down off her hearth, off the bed, 15 years old. She never forgot this, and he stepped in the doorway, filled the doorway. He said, this night, Jesus Christ has come into this house. And she said it was like an electric shock struck her at the top of her head and went straight through to her feet. At 15 years old, she never forgot it. 5 years later, he came back and married her. He was so much older than her. He died some years later. He was known as the man of God. He was known as the evangelist. He was known as the Bible man. He had all kinds of, he walked over the entire nation and preached. And in the winter, in the summer, whenever it was, he walked throughout that whole country of Yugoslavia that's torn now with war. And he knew that God was walking in his shoe leather. He was put in jail, his son told me, over 100 times put in prison for his testimony of Christ. And when he died, he left a young widow, a German officer in the German army, fell in love with her and wanted to marry her. She told me, she says, I told him, I am married.
Well, together. Yeah. Hallelujah.
She could have, but that's the kind of commitment that she had. Oh, I tell you, friends, it is a real revelation when we understand, and it is something from God that's a reality in you. Tell me, young people, and I've heard Brother Jeff, I've been observing what has been said over the pulpit. Each night it's been speaking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There is a place where you don't go on a roller coaster anymore. There's a place where you settle it. For me, it was 18 years old. I took, in my prayer and weeping and sobbing, I took my billfold out, laid it on the table, took my on the bed and laid my watch beside it. I said, I dedicate them to you. I'll never take them up again. I am yours, entirely yours. And I can say, from that time, there is a great hunger in my heart. From that time. And there isn't a boy or a girl, there's not a man or woman, but what can say the same thing. For me, it was the same as that Buddy Roberts that was in the cornfield. And he said to God, if you don't fill me with the Holy Ghost, you'll find a pile of bones here when you come back. That's the kind of resolve that God wants to hear. And I believe that can be here this evening. You need to say that. I'm urging you to come to that place. Say this up and down, in and out, joy and sadness. This is all over. I am here to, with the knowledge that God is walking in me. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Joseph, back to him for a moment. He actually lived out the prophecy of the Messiah that we spoke about last night. He lived out the entire prophecy of a nation being born in a day. He lived out a prophecy. He interpreted it perfectly. The Jews at this time still can't see it, but he lived it out. He interpreted it perfectly. Benjamin coming, as we spoke of last night. And all of these details were interpreted in his life perfectly. But now I'm going to take you to the one I asked the Lord to stop Brother Jeff from speaking on. Luke 24, the two men on the way to Emmaus. You know the story well. And it starts off by telling us, and there were two of them went the same day to a village called Emmaus. But before... Don't be distracted by reading just for a moment. Brother Branham, in his last four messages, and I refer to this often. Sometimes I get asked quite frequently, "What? I don't have any idea. I don't have any order to how to listen to the message and whatever more." I suggest that you listen to them in series. And because Brother Branham goes from one thought to another and ties them together. But what has captured my mind for years, and still, if you catch the word right, it tantalizes my mind because I have not been able to come to a satisfactory solution within my own soul. Why God had Brother Branham speak the rapture on December the 4th, things that are to be on December the 5th, modern events made clear by prophecy on the 6th, leadership on the 7th, then had communion a few days later and left, which is the same pattern Jesus took. Brother Branham uses the phrase, this great order of the rapture, only once in all of his ministry, and that was on December the 4th in the rapture, where he calls it the shout, the voice, and the trumpet. The three-part. The shout, the voice, and the trumpet, three-part. And then the very next night, now watch. And in that message, he uses Psalms 27 as his, in the day of trouble, he'll hide me. In his pavilion, in the secret of his pavilion, he will hide me. Not in his pavilion, but in the secret of his tabernacle. In the secret of his dwelling place, he's going to hide me. And then, so it's talking about dwelling places, dwelling places, dwelling places. And the next night, then he begins and he says, he goes to John 14, in my Father's house, dwelling place once again. He says, I want this service now tonight to tie into last night's service. Things that are to be. He's pointing future. And then the next night, he goes to Luke 24. After the resurrection, and I have studied it very, very closely, I personally believe that he walked through the shout, the voice, and the trumpet. Because the shout, he was in his last services, and the shout now was finished to the living. And the very next night, he goes to the chapter where he says, I'm leaving you now. I'm going to go. And Thomas says, where are you going, Lord? And he says, well, the way you know. And he says, I don't know the way. If we don't know where you're going. And they're all troubled about where he was going. He was trying to tell them that now he was passing through. He's going to leave them. He's going to death. Things that are to be. And he's telling them, he said, you know, I'll be with you, and so on and so forth. And explaining the resurrection to them, that death didn't end it. And then the very next night, he says, modern events made clear by the prophecy. Amen. Now listen to me, friends. Listen very close. The Jews, as I spoke about in detail last night, they do not know, the Spirit of God has not revealed to them that the whole account of Joseph and his brethren coming to him and him yearning for Benjamin, they have no knowledge that that is a prophecy about to be unfolded right now. Amen. They have no knowledge of that. And unfortunately, there's many in the message, they read modern events made clear by the prophecy, doesn't even dawn on them to ask about what is the prophecy Brother Branham's talking about, where is the prophecy? The prophecy, he's saying Luke 24 is a prophecy. And we look at it as an account of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is saying through the Son of Man ministry, this is a prophecy for the people of this hour. A prophecy. It had been told. This now prophecy, and I'm going to try to move along as quickly as possible, but I don't want you to miss this because this is the core of my whole message. Jesus had told them clearly in the scripture. See if I don't have it. He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed and 3 days and after 3 days rise again. I ask you, did that sound difficult? I ask you, how is it they didn't understand that? He was expounding the scripture. I must be rejected by the Pharisees, by the scribes, by the leaders, and I will be killed. No mystery, is it? And after 3 days, I will rise again. That isn't complicated, is it? But they missed it. They missed the spoken interpretation of the word. And so here we are now in Luke 24 with these same disciples he taught the scripture. Now he has lived out the prophecy. He's actually lived it out. He has died and he's resurrected. The women have seen a strange vision of angels, they said. And they're walking together on the road to Emmaus, saddened, reasoning between themselves over the things that had taken place. I know you as believers well enough. I don't have to know a lot about you individually, but I know in the general body of believers, we have had many questions. Why did this happen? Why has this taken place? Why is it this way in the message? Why, and why? And they were asking why. Where did the great things go to? Oh, we walked in such glory and such victory, remember? Do you remember the great signs and wonders? to remember back there. Oh, remember when we thought nothing could stand before him? And then everything kind of squeezed down and tightened up. And then he stood, I just can't understand it. Then the word became silent. Seemed that the word became powerless in our lives. And he stood there. That word that always had an answer suddenly had no answers. And the message went sideways. But they were believers and could not get free. Are you with me? And so now, even that which he had, follow me closely, which he had interpreted in spoken word form, now he has interpreted in a fulfillment form, and he's walking with them. The crucifixion's happened. The burial has taken place. The earthquake, the resurrection. The women have been to the tomb. He's not there. They've sent word back to the disciples, and these brethren are sincere believers and still confused about what had happened, and now it's all over. There's a marvelous phrase that I want to leave with you tonight. And Jesus himself drew near. And when I was in prayer today, I said, Lord, let that be this evening. Let that be tonight. There's many of us. We can't explain everything. We don't know why everything has gone the way it's gone. But there's one who can explain it. There's one who's here. There's a man who can turn on the light. Let Jesus himself draw near to you. And he walked with them in their questioning and in their heaviness. He walked with them. What are these things? What are these things that you're speaking? They look to the word in fulfillment, the word in its unveiling. They look to the word unveiled and asked, are you a stranger in Jerusalem? Listen to me quietly. The word, while it's being fulfilled, can look so strange. When Brother Branham was here, the spirit of Elijah covering the earth, and the scripture of Malachi 4 looked so strange, the great leaders couldn't receive it. It was so strange. But Jesus himself, he would not allow these disciples to go with these heavy hearts and these questions, and the Bible tells us. And Jesus himself drew near and went with them. And their eyes were holden that they should not know him. Now the point I want to make, I want to impress you with, it was not their determination. They were not going saying, we must find out. We must discover. We must ponder the depths of this. No, it was the determination of God. It's God that worketh in us to do his will. It was God walking with them. It wasn't them saying, we've got to get this revelation. It was Jesus Christ himself walking with them saying, you're going to understand. I'm not going to leave you till you understand what's happened. Can you say amen? Amen. He's not going to leave you till you understand where you're at. No, sir. He's not. I don't care how you feel. I don't care how low you feel. He's not going to leave you until you know him in his present form. All three of these stages of interpretation are here in Matthew and in Luke 24. He had spoken the word to them clearly. Now he came and interpreted it by living it out,
Secondly, and because they were elect of God and still didn't see it, he came around again in what I call an added measure of grace. With a determination. I love that principle. The determination is of God. It's not of them. It's not of us. It's not us that work in us. It is God that works in us. Both to do, both to will and to do his own good pleasure. And it was God in Christ that was walking with them, saying, you're going to understand this. I'm going to stay with you. I'm going to walk right to your home. I'm going to come right into your house. And you may have heard me say this before. These brothers didn't have the depth of revelation they needed. In fact, as they didn't have a whole lot of what they needed, there was the resurrected Christ, the Messiah, the most glorious thing that had happened. Brother Branham called it the most glorious week. And they were in the middle of it and were missing it. Brother Branham said, there's one thing you're going to take with you when you cross over. Only one thing. How many can tell it?
Character.
Say it again.
Character.
Character. And it gives me great joy to announce to you, these two brothers didn't have revelation, but they had character. And the Bible says they came to their house, and it was evening time, and the Messiah made as though he would go on. He was going to continue. He was moving right on. And the Bible says they didn't, it doesn't say they invited him. It says they constrained him. They took a hold of him as they would in the Middle East, in that they do a lot of things with their hands, embraced him. Perhaps, you cannot go on. It's too late. And we're weary now. And here they were holding the word. They were holding the interpretation of the word. Oh, do you see it, friends? I'll tell you something, my brother, my sister, you think you're here at a camp meeting, you embrace one another. Let me tell you something, you're embracing the interpretation of God's word. I want you to shake hands with somebody right beside you now and recognize its interpretation. God is interpreting his word here. God has chosen him before the foundation of the world to interpret the scripture. And they constrained him, and he went in with them. And the Bible says he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread, the way he took the word, the way he handled the word, and their eyes were opened, and they saw who he was. My, it's our Lord. Had you talked to them 3 or 4 days before and asked them the question, if you had been there and asked them the question, do you know who Jesus of Nazareth is? They would have said, yes, sir. Do you know who this message is? Absolutely. Are you a message believer to the umpteenth degree? Heart and soul and body. Wonderful. If you'd have met the same fellas on the road to Damascus and you'd have said, do you know Jesus of Nazareth? They say, well, if you'd asked that to me a few days ago, I could have told you. Right now, I'm not too sure. He's vanished on us. I can't see him. We used to be able to feel him. I can't feel him. I understood it one time. Now I don't understand it anymore. Right now, you shouldn't have asked me that right now. I'm in a deep quandary. I'm trying to reason these things out. I never expected this to happen into the message. Fear not, little children. It's the Father's goodwill to bring forth his purpose in you. It is God that worketh in you both to do and to will and to do his good pleasure. You may think I'm raising my voice too much. I'll tell you, I wish right now I could preach to the world. It's not us, it's God.
It's not our determination, it's God's determination. Yes, you need to be resolved. You need to be determined that these things, these upsets won't disturb you or deter you. But in the final conclusion, it is the determination of Christ to reveal himself to you. And then he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. And this is when I bowed my head and said, Lord, stop Jeff. While he walked with them, and the Word himself took the Word, the prophets, and all through the Psalms, and spoke to them concerning himself. The Word took the spoken interpretation and pointed to the living interpretation. And because that spoken interpretation now was living out, their hearts burned because it was happening. And you may be here tonight and say, I don't understand everything that's being spoken, but there's something in my soul that is burning. I'll tell you why it's burning. Not because it's Brother Biscoe or Brother Brown or Brother Jason or some other brother preaching. It's because prophecy is being fulfilled. You say, what's burning? That's what's burning. You at the back, that's what's burning. Not just a feeling, it is the prophecy being fulfilled that's burning. It's modern events made clear by the prophecy. The modern event is that prophecy of Luke 24 arriving at its season. The season is now. Now. Many in the message don't even realize he's been walking with us. Don't even realize he's been walking. Think he's some 50, 100 million light years away in space. He's not away in space. Been walking right beside you in the fulfillment of the scripture. And they had a camp meeting right in that house. My, their eyes were open and he vanished from their sight, and they ran to some disciples with lesser revelation. Well, I'm glad you're giving me some leeway tonight. Ran to somebody who didn't have the revelation. If you don't hear this, you're not going to make the rapture. No, that isn't exactly what they said. They said, he's alive. We've seen him. He's here. He walked with us. He's not away. He's not in the tomb. He's not in heaven. He's here. Glory! Hallelujah! He's here! Hallelujah! Isn't he wonderful? He's walking with us! The interpretation of the Word is here! You're the interpretation! By they got to these disciples, they thought they understood it fully and completely, but when they got to the room and the great apostles were sealed in the room, those that should have been leaders in this whole thing, they're all holed up. For fear. And these disciples came in and said, he's risen, he's alive. And as they spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst, now the second time, and said unto them, peace be unto you. Amen. But they were terrified. Amen. Including the ones that just had the revelation.
Go ahead.
Now, you know, you can just sit there and kind of take it from me as a sermon if you want. I'm telling you, your prophet said there's a prophecy. We're going to experience these things. Oh, we're going to have such revelation. I just can't. I'm so full, I'm going to burst. And the next moment, you're just terrified. Where'd he go? This is so strange now. I never thought this was going to happen. They couldn't understand completely this theophany or this body that he was in. And they said, told him to be at peace. He said, why are you troubled? And why do thoughts arise in your heart? Behold my hands and my feet. It is I myself. The Spirit is not flesh and bones, as you see me have. He didn't say blood, because the blood had been shed. Don't ask me to explain it all. And when he had thus spoken, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they believed not for joy and wondered, he said unto them, have you here any meat? Now you would have thought maybe he'd have sat down and said, just sit down. I'm going to give you one of the greatest revelations that you ever heard. Now this is how he revealed it. So ordinary. He comes so ordinary. So simple. That's why we miss it. So, excuse me, have you got anything here to eat? Wouldn't you think that'd be strange if I said, hey, Brother Jeff, you got anything to eat here? He said, what's this man doing? They said, well, yeah, just a second. We got a little fish and some honeycomb here. And they give it to him. He terrified them just a few moments ago. Say, can you see these great apostles sitting there and watching the fulfilled word? Eat this fish. Eat this honeycomb. And then while they were standing there watching him, is gone. You know, it never was a question in my mind that the Lord Jesus in that body could vanish like that and disappear and go out of that sealed room. But I always wondered where that fish and honey went. I tell you what, friends, that's quite a body. And the scripture says he will give you a body like unto his glorious body. Says, we're going to eat over there. We're going to sit down together. We're going to eat. We're going to fellowship. Don't ask me to explain it. All I tell you is this is a prophecy that we are in the midst of fulfilling at this time. That's what's happening. You're going to interpret fully. You know the world has the rapture interpreted? You're going to interpret it. And when it's interpreted in you, they're going to discover they knew nothing about it. Do you know that the devil thinks he's got control of us by death? But there's a prophecy that lays in this word that says the last enemy to be destroyed is death, and you're going to be God's victory over death. He promised it. He spoke it. You're going to interpret it. It's going to happen. The prophet told you how it's going to happen. He said there's going to be a sweep. A sweep. I don't know what kind of a sweep, but you're going to interpret that sweep over you. There's going to be a change in your atoms. I don't know how. He said it. You're going to interpret it. Can you say, praise God, I'm ready to interpret that. Are you ready to interpret that? Hallelujah. The Lutherans came on the wave of justification by faith. They spoke it. The bride interpreted it. Yes, sir. And the very thing they spoke, they don't possess anymore. And their leader never did tell them, you never did sin. That is total justification. Brother Branham spoke it. You are the interpretation of that. And that is why Satan would impose upon your mind. Are you listening to me? He would impose upon your mind guilt. He would clog up your memory with every kind of condemnation. And that is why this word had to come. That is why, furthermore, the prophet put his hands in the air. A sword strikes his hand sharp. The word of God, why, had to hew that condemnation out of us. Take that guilt away. Hallelujah. Take that defeat and that negativism away. The word is energized to do that. You remember my first service? You only can give yourself over to it. You must give yourself. If you lay back in reservation, say, well, I don't know, I'll just wait and see. You'll never see it. It'll never come your way. But if you say in your heart, I don't fully understand it, but I say it's in the Word. And Brother Biscoe has supported it, amply supported it by the message. And my soul is saying, yay. Yay. Then what you want to do is confess it with your mouth. Yay. Hallelujah. Amen. I was looking for a quote that I love so dearly. My. Brother Branham says in the seals, see if I can just find it here real quickly, because I'm going to close with this. And I know the devil hates this quote because he always gives me trouble when I try to find it. I know I have it right here. And I'm going to challenge the devil if he doesn't let me find it. I'm going to quote it from memory. I read it today. I read it over. I've read it perhaps dozens and dozens of times without any exaggeration. And I said, now I'm going to read that to the people. Well, I don't know. I can't find it. But I'm going to tell you what he says. He says, before the word, before it's a word, he said, it's a thought.
Amen.
And he said, before it's a thought, I think then he makes reference that God had to create that thought. It wasn't the first quote I mentioned. Then he said, God reveals that to you. He said, it's still a thought.
Amen.
After it's revealed to you. Say, oh my, he's revealed his thought to me. Brother Branham says, it's still a thought until you speak it. That's why you can say, all these things sound wonderful, but you have to take another step. Even after it's revealed to you. And I trust that to some tonight that can say, God has revealed some things to me. You've got to take another step according to the seal's message. You've got to speak it and confess it. And that's the only way for it to truly anchor within you. The scripture speaks about the bride. Brother Branham spoke about a bride. He interpreted what she'd be like and what she would, her conduct would be like, and all the rest of it. You are the interpretation.
That's right.
And in some cases, God comes in an added measure of grace. We have people come around, they say, happens quite frequently. I know it's happened in your area. Happened just the other day. Total unsaved man said to one of our people, where do you find women like this? Where do you find people like this? I've had people come in from Pentecostal churches and say, where do you find children like this? Where do you find young people like this? What is it they're seeing? What are they looking at? They've never heard the word. They're looking at an interpretation of the word of God, a manifestation of the word of God. The bride of Jesus Christ is the interpretation of the word of God. And you have been called, according to the scripture, to live out the prophecy of Luke, the 24th chapter. That is a calling that God has laid upon you. And I say, so be it, Lord. I trust that I shall be here. Oh, I desire so earnestly. And as I get up, a few years have gone by since I've been here in Lima. Oh, I pray earnestly, oh God, let me be a part of Luke 24. I've seen this as a prophecy for many years now. Let me be a part of it. Hallelujah. Stay with me, Lord. Jesus himself drew near. And I'm asking tonight, I prayed before I came here, that Jesus himself would draw near to you. Make known your very desires. And let you know it's not in vain. And the hardship was not in vain. The pit experience was not in vain. The temptation was not in vain. The slavery was not in vain. Can you say amen?
Amen.
The heartache, the turmoil, the wounds were not in vain. I'm speaking down where you live. I know I am. These things you've experienced are not in vain. They're for the glory of God. They have happened as part of the fulfillment or the interpretation. You are the interpreters of the spoken word of God. Hallelujah. Let's give him thanksgiving. Let's stand to our feet. Oh, we thank you, Lord. What a glorious word you have given us. What a glorious calling. And tonight, we say in accordance with your word, it is God that worketh in us, both to will and to do your good pleasure. Father, each of us have had our own individual, unique desires for this camp. We've desired one thing. Perhaps some have desired healing. Others have desired the baptism of the Holy Spirit to know and have the assurance that they're sealed. Some are desiring perhaps salvation. They do not have the assurance of it. Others have had a spirit hounding them, plaguing them, bringing them into depression. We take our position right now, Lord Jesus. We stand upon the word of God. We say the Bible stands, the word of God stands. And Satan, you have no rights whatsoever to this God's property. But yet, Lord, above and beyond all of this, I'm conscious and I want the people to be conscious what your desire was. You let a prophet travel 7 times around the world, telling the secrets of our hearts. In the last 3.5 years, you even restrained him until he said, don't pull on me like that. I'm here now for the message. You wanted to tell us what was the secret of your heart. And you did so. And you said, peace, be still. Don't fear. Don't be afraid. It is I. Hallelujah. It is you. Lord, we wouldn't know what we know today. We wouldn't feel the way we feel. And this grand audience of people would not have gathered here unless they had known that it was you walking with them in this message. I commit this service and the words that have been spoken to you. And Jesus, I pray that you'll grant me this request, that you'll draw near, especially to every needy one that is needy spiritually. Don't let them walk out of here the way they came in. Would you meet with them? Yourself, draw near. May that sacred presence now envelop them. Lord, perhaps a young person, a father, a mother. We do not know who. Envelop them, O gracious Savior. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray.
Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, how wonderful. I wonder if we could sing just, "Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me." Turn the service over to our brother Jenkins. Oh, how. Again, I really feel that we should just do something. The scripture says we should pray for one another. And I do not know how many that God may have touched tonight, but something sprung up in your heart when I said Jesus himself drew near. Something within you said, "That is what I need. That is what I need." Would you like to raise your hand right where you are? And I'm going to ask for the saints that are nearby. Let us just lay our hand on one another's shoulder. Those that have raised their hand, let's pray for one another. Let's pray for one another. Lord, what an audience of hands. What a thirst. Surely you will come to the hungry soul. You'll come to that soul that's thirsting after. Blessed are ye when ye thirst and hunger, thirst after righteousness. You shall be filled. You shall be satisfied. You shall receive your portion. That's according to the promise of God. Yea, and amen to them that believe. Oh, blood, I pray long after this meeting is over, you'll go to the cabins with them. You'll go in the car with them. When they lay their head upon the pillow, may that sacred presence surround them. Like a glory cloud. Blessed be your glorious name. We thank you for your presence. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I wonder if we can sing to Sister. Oh, he's here. Hallelujah. He's here. He is here.
Sing this song unto the Lord. Get out your 10-string instruments, and this is clapping unto the Lord.
I have found his grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free, yes, free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. I have found the pleasures I once craved.
been told. I have found the joy no tongue can tell, how its waves of glory roar. It is like a great overflowing well springing up within my soul. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, and the half has never yet been told. I have found the joy no tongue can tell, how its waves of glory roll. And it's like a great flowing well. My soul, it is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full. And the half has never yet been told.
Give the Lord a clap offering, will you? Amen. Blessed Assurance. Let's just sing that unto Him. We'll dismiss you with this song. If you want to stay and worship a while, that's up to you.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story. My story. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior.